bringing in. I know this is all political, but he's bringing in the very Arab nations that Israel once fought again and fought against in the past. And maybe through this Abraham Accords, they think they're going to have some fellowship with these people or relationship with them, maybe on the basis of trade. But they're only getting closer to the ultimate escalation.
Things of Israel.
there's a few, but not many. But how many churches around this country really are sharing what's going on with Israel? A lot of churches on Sunday mornings, for example, thank God they do this. They will say, you know, pray for Israel. Let's remember Israel. You ask about teaching. I don't think that there's much going on. I don't, especially those that have a media plan. It's just not happening. And I can say that because we're not seeing the nation change its direction. When the church gets it right, it doesn't just stay in the walls of the church. When the right teaching is going forth from the pulpit on a Sunday morning, it has an impact Monday through Saturday, whatever more you want to say. But that's how we can know, ladies and gentlemen, because when the church gets it right, it's preaching what's right. And we'll go back to it. If the church would just preach the cross, every aspect would be addressed. And that even includes getting elements of Bible prophecy and current events accurate. It's just that's the truth. But let me say this. Going through the Holocaust Memorial Museum, I was reminded. That's an incredible experience. That is they both were fantastic. I've been to some other ones as well, but the ones in Washington, D.C. and Jerusalem were incredible. But I was reminded, and it was made real to me, what took place leading up to the actual Holocaust. And sentiment that existed in Germany. Germany was all throughout Europe. And that same thing. I mean, Brother Swagger, I felt like I was looking at headlines and current events, but it was from the 1930s. Sentiment of the world, looking at the ship, the St. Louis that came with so many Jews, thousands of Jews. That they were coming to Cuba turned them away. And the United States said no. It was said that the Jews on that ship, they could see Florida. They could see the piers, the docks. They could see the land of the United States.
And so
They were that close to life. But Roosevelt said no. That ship. So when I look at that, and I look at what's happening,
and he's saying they just keep, but look, what they got is about evil.
Yeah, well, President Roosevelt was acting, I'm going to be unkind, but the man was as cowardly as our president right now. But yeah, there were reasons, and I know at the time there were things going on, we keep going to that, but the fact is, my kid. If the United States would have opened up
the world to the Jewish people
at that time, I don't believe we would have had a
bomb. About.
I believe it would have all been
a bomb. It allowed you to do the same.
But we suffered greatly as a result.
I don't doubt that at all. Swagger, as I said, Melissa, I want to repeat something that Dave mentioned
over the text,
but America, Jesus said, a house divided against itself cannot stand. What's sad is concerning Hezbollah, concerning Hamas. At least they're unified. And what we're seeing are many of their efforts being successful because their people are unified.
I like the language.
Philosophy.
Well, I don't know. His mama was out on the. You know, that's just
the reality is America.
Look at
raising civil war.
Expose you for what you are.
And the sad reality is, if we do not unify, if we don't have
leadership,
we don't have better leadership. But we know there's always been a segment of the world that would never agree with.
Beginning in Lord, thank you.
Or with biblical principles. But at least we could call the church to unify under the truth. And under the banner of the truth, what's happening, though, is we have bought the lie that moral issues are political issues, and the church should stay out. When the church's influence is when the church and its influence stays away from politics, moral issues, there's no light to guide the nation. The very thing that Satan wants is for the church to stay away. is for the Christian to butt out of it. And what's happening to the modern pastor and preachers, he's fallen under this pressure, and really it's just deception. But we need to realize that the identity of America is at stake. We won't stand as a nation if we... And what's happened? You called this out in a message, Brother Swagger, in the 80s.
The outrageous kids.
I believe it's the Equal Rights Amendments.
They are it's doing evil.
What we've been seeing, I just bring out something that Dave said. What are the women's rights under Hezbollah? What are the women's rights under Hamas? And then question, what are they in Israel? They're a free nation.
Yeah.
And the hilarious thing about what's going on is it's
all day.
It's a fool's game. It really is. But,
lack of all day.
You said this in the 80s. We have embraced a humanistic education in this nation. This, and it's striking.
Everybody's here for me.
The public
school. Is it supposed to be coming? Is it another supposed to be coming to do this? Is it supposed to be coming to do this?
Yeah, because we have been raising our children, the next generation, on a secularist education. And what are the results of that secularist education? Poverty.
You don't win.
Inflation.
They give me walking over with the camera, not going to pick me
up. Homosexuality. Transgenderism.
This
is what America is touting as our new foundation. And we've rejected the Bible, said get it out.
I can see somebody standing out there filming, you do that. You don't want to be seen. I get that.
Now I don't know about that old side.
That is the word of God. I mean, today, we are a nation divided.
I was surprised that it's been about 6 months ago. But I can't think of the man's name. He's been on the staff at the
press. I'm still doing it.
He's Jewish, that's brilliant individual.
I did tell I was in Texas over the weekend. That feels emergency, yeah, but they done the same. So just keep going like this, my Lord.
Let me tell you this real quick. When we were there in Washington, we stopped to the office of Congressman Clay Higgins.
I went to sleep to it. Hold back up in the morning.
Rudy was on Francis and Friends.
For over a year now.
And the congressman was not there. He had come back home. But when we walked in, his staff said, would you like to see his office? I said, sure. So we walked in. And they didn't know we'd be coming by or anything like that. And I looked over and he has two chairs.
That's going to bring them closer together. No, he's going to be just like them. Well, he's just like that isn't any
there.
Fucking dope out there.
Pictures. And
I can't stop saying it because he did. And I give to the manager. She did say she's seen it.
Was the expositor study Bible.
Fucking dope out here. She all outside his night. She all outside.
I said exactly.
On my side. On my side, when she was.
You know what that is?
I'm not going to know. Wow, he's sucking it out there.
What that was, but apparently the congressman rents it. That sucks. And he had a signature edition over on his, where he's supposed
to. I take the management about it.
I was extremely encouraged to see that he didn't just receive the expositors as a gift and put it away somewhere, but it was open, on display, there.
That's why I can stand on saying they get it live. And when the woman in the red car brought him back, blown out of his mind.
Well, yeah, that's it. It's all over. There's no one that can work on it. And,
I'd like to do that.
Yeah, that would be something to do.
You could be involved, couldn't you? She was pushing him out. That video's out. You got to go back almost a year, but maybe not even that. I don't even think it's a year. But it's over. But they love them now.
Just let me know and we'll start sending them.
Because
we have some addresses. We will start now with our study for today on spiritual warfare.
Should we start it before or after the break?
We'll start after the break. We'll be right back.
She sounded like I was gonna say, this is when she was talking crazy too in the car. It wasn't like she was letting
had some sense. That could never happen.
That's what she speaks. When she told the police, what, Lord? I don't have nobody coming to my house. I have my house dark. How's that hurting you? And when they came to me, I could tell them how she was affecting me. No, Lord. They knew who the perpetrator was. Just the Lord ever speak. The Lord was speaking in their mouth. You can't even do that. That's a figure of speech literally with us. You can't even raise a leg. Or wash her behind. And he can't even. He look at him. He don't even know to go to the bathroom.
From Jimmy Swagger Ministries, this is the Sun Life Broadcast.
Oh, that's right. He go to the bathroom himself.
What's he doing all this, man? Lord Jesus, thank you.
You don't even get the spot.
There's no to come sell dope to you and go. And the great car come to use it with you. And Mecca already posted up there. And she get high with her children. Who want that line but a fool?
And Henry Kissinger gave instructions.
And the boy who telling her mama be careful, you knock up her daughter, he get high with her. Video on video, okay, so you know.
But somebody has a cigarette.
They said, Kissinger said, sir.
Of dope.
They're planning to be rolling in 5 minutes, so you'll get a job of profit in 10 minutes.
Lord Jesus, huh?
The tape of the commander, and as God would do,
The sound was so amplified that they were under heavy bombardment in order to retreat. And it was documented. So that's what God can do. But you know, we've talked earlier about the different Arab nations. The Arab nations do not get along with each other. They will unify around one single purpose, and that is the annihilation of Israel.
They said, God,
if Israel were not in the picture, they would be turning on Hezbollah and Hamas. Don't really, they don't like each other. They would be at war with each other. But they unify around the annihilation of Israel.
Yeah.
So Dr. Watson made a comment earlier about some of these special interest groups in the United States. They don't like each other. But none of them are large enough to cause any speak on their own. It's just a minor inconvenience like a mosquito individual.
When you tell you what to do, do it. The wish you will,
it's like evil unifies for the purpose of annihilating righteousness. And it invaded the church, and it started with the church. And what we've seen in many of our denominations that at one time were solid Bible preaching, repentance-based denomination. Presbyterian, Episcopalians, Methodists, Lutheran. And look at where they
are. That may have been the boy's, her grandson, River. He's just a foolish. If she brings over
the church, they will not preach righteousness. And if they're not preaching righteousness,
when did he really, like Lord said, try to beat the camera? How foolish is Christian? Well, don't too, but he was high too when he was. It was foolish. That video was too.
Pentecostal churches, you could tell them from most of the others. You would think that they were not Pentecostal because in their desire to be accepted, we have compromised the things that made us unique. Now there's a growing movement to rekindle and go back to our roots. It's like you've been preaching the message of the cross now for over 30 years. We begin to see now in some of our churches, most of the brethren around this table, the churches we go into are accepted. I know a lot of my friends that are in the Church of God are getting back to the basics of preaching the cross, preaching repentance, preaching righteousness and holiness. Preaching
and then we drop in her circle.
In our lives. So it started to turn around.
It's not like it, never.
Like it.
This is what you do.
Again.
I believe the big ships turn something.
The bigger the ship, the longer
the ship. Go back to sleep, baby.
There's a move, Calvin Brothers Fire. If not, this nation will totally fail.
And confidence, Lord Jesus, thank you.
The church will fail before the nation will.
That's exactly what we see happening. So there's got to be a great awakening to happen. We need the church to be prepared for it. And it's going to be
which
I think we're going to begin to look at that.
I didn't even catch myself dancing up. I don't know. I hope I wouldn't snort if I was. Okay, it happens.
Relying on the things of the world that will be purpose-driven or other elements. So those have to be repetitive. Psychology has to be repetitive. You brought it up at the service Sunday morning, which, by the way, sir, was an excellent message yesterday. I pray that people that didn't hear it go listen to it, and those that listened to it go back and rehear it once again. That we're talking about two spiritual laws, the law of the spirit of life and the law of sin and death. And if we don't understand the law of the spirit of life, the law of sin and death is going to reign, and it's going to take its domination over us in every area of living.
It's already done in many circles.
Sad to say, but by the grace of God, we're going to plow through this. Because I believe the Lord is coming back for appearance.
And the only bulwark against him is the cross.
That's right.
I've been scoffed at by some honestly believe that just as impactful as the Protestant Reformation, the First and Second Great Awakening, and the Azusa Street Revival and beginning of the modern Pentecostal movement, I believe the message of the cross can make that kind of impact.
I agree.
On the nation and on the world, it can be another great move of God that is God's final message for the church to get back to the cross, to believe in the finished work of Calvary for justification and for sanctification, and have a cross-centered church and a cross-centered community and a cross-centered nation. That would be that's the only thing that will save our nation. So I 100% believe that it can be as impactful and as important as these other times when God has come on the scene in the past with the First and Second Great Awakening, with the Reformation, with the early Pentecostal movement, the beginning of Pentecost in the 20th century. So I do think it's God's message for the church and for the world.
Well, the message of the church is the family worship center, it's called. It's bigger than you think. And it really is. I don't think people see the scope and the size of what God's doing. This is the culmination of what began in the Reformation. We have the beginning of the Reformation. Now we have the message that's going to bring the culmination, because it puts every other pieces of it together and brings it to its proper understanding, its proper foundation, and how to build upon it. But the Reformation didn't have some of those elements, but we have all that light that gradually was being revealed by the Lord through the Azusa Street, through the missionary outreach that took place in the 20th century. And now we have the coming together of this whole movement that the Lord has brought coming to the people now.
Look at your son, the Spirit of God is moving. It's working for you. And I do believe that what Dr. Watt said, that it's what the Spirit is saying to the churches at the cross. I think that's what the Holy Spirit is saying to the churches. And
when we read the text, we haven't quite gotten to it yet this morning, but if I could lay a little bit of foundation to start in Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 10, the very first word is final. Now, the Greek word for that, the boy, has a connotation.
You know better.
It's really, is you've got to remain. And see, that's what we've been talking about. We have gotten away from what we know is right, that God's calling us back. So when he tells us, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord, he's telling us, remain strong in the Lord. It doesn't matter what the opposition is doing. It doesn't matter what the opposition is saying. Remain strong in the Lord. And that's what he's encouraging as he begins going through this entire section on spiritual warfare. You don't go into spiritual warfare as a coward.
You grow to endure in strength, is what he's going to talk about next.
Exactly.
We're to stay in there, but we're to endure with strength, but it's not ours. It's his.
It's war.
It's war. Absolutely.
It's a spiritual war, but it's war. Okay? Pick it up with the 10th verse, please.
Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord.
Be continually strengthened, which one does my constant faith in the cross.
You notice here it says be strong. Doesn't say act like you're strong. Mm. But in Christ we can be something. The emphasis there is on the being, not on the doing.
Well, the Holy Spirit expects us to be strong. Have not I commanded thee to be strong in love?
Good courage.
What's the next line?
Good courage.
And be strong. I'm going to recommend that you be strong of good courage, be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, with the servant of thy voice. Praise God. That word given to Joshua, it's a long, long course, just as appropriate today.
Yes.
as it was then. And I commanded you to be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. That's a powerful statement.
Isn't that at the time when Joshua and Israel were standing on the brink of going in and taking the promised land? Finally, they had gotten to the point where God wanted it to be 40 years before.
Right, yeah.
Is that where we are at? Standing on the brink?
I pray we're not at the beginning. I pray we're at the conclusion. It's a command. Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid. Neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. God gave that to me at a very crucial time in my own life and ministry that I'm going to take the time to go into now. But in the last few days,
strongly.
Have not I commanded you to be strong and of good courage? Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. What a promise.
I swear he was in covenant with his people. They could depend on the strength of the Lord because they were in covenant and he was in covenant with them. He was telling them, expect the power, expect the strength, expect the help of Jehovah. Why? Because they were in covenant. What will hinge on our Lord, whether or not we walk in the strength of the Lord. This word power can become an issue for some, because if we don't answer the question, where do we get this strength from correctly? We will not be able to, as remain strong in the Lord. We have to see that it comes by our union with Christ and nothing else, not by what we've done, not our prayer life.
He said, your brother don't do that.
Strong, he said, in the Lord. That is taking us back to the salvation experience. It is a better covenant based on better promises, and we too can expect on a daily basis the strength, being empowered by the Spirit. Why? We can expect it to come because we're under a better covenant.
The cross of Christ is the signet of the new covenant.
Yes.
It's what holds it together.
Yes.
And without it, we have no covenant.
And it makes it available for every Christian, Brother Swain. There's not one under the blood. There's not one in Christ who cannot experience the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, he does many things. He'll give us power for service. But here, this is a power for victory. This is a power for strength. And every single child of God who names the name of Christ as their Lord and Savior today can expect, as Joshua did long ago, to be strong in the Lord. We have a better covenant. It's not based on my experience, not based on my denomination, not based on the church I go to, but the Christ under whom I have been placed.
We can expect God to move. That's exactly as he moved for Joshua.
Yes. And even a greater way, Brother Swagger.
Right.
There's a victory we can have.
We have the Holy Spirit now in a way that they did not have then.
Absolutely. The giants they faced primarily were physical. But we're facing the devils of hell. We're wrestling against not flesh and blood, but principalities. And these adversaries are bred for us. If we'll be strengthened in the Lord.
The atonement is a fact.
Yes.
It's not something that will going to take place 1,000 years from now. It's a fact now.
Hallelujah.
I commanded you to be strong and have a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed. For the Lord thy God is with thee, whithersoever thou goest. And
Lord, thank you.
I believe he's speaking that word to us today, exactly as he did 3,000 years ago.
Okay. That was with Lord. Thank you.
But like I said a moment ago, the cross of Christ is the cement that holds this covenant to God. And, but the grace of God, we're going to see preachers of the thousands taking it up.
Yes. Why did he start
preaching the cross?
Why did he add that note? Be not afraid. Some are fearful today, brothers, right? Anxiety, fear. But he said, the Lord thy God is with thee. He's with you today.
Those who step up are going to see God move as they've never seen it. Praise God. We run out of time, ladies and gentlemen. But what a way to close the program. Thank you for being with us. No, this is the next program. God bless you.
In your name.
Thank you for joining us on today's program, The Message of the Cross. Watch program archives on the live app watch.sunlifetv.com.
Taking the message of the cross to the world. This is the Sun Life Broadcasting Network.
You don't get a strike.
Oh.
time. I've seen it. Lord,
some hands, hug some necks, pat some folk on the back, and